Good morning, students. In our last class, I discussed about the magnetisms. So, in continuations of the magnetisms, today I will discuss force on a charged particle and then magnetic dipole and magnetization in material, and on the basis of this magnetizations, how material can be classified, we will be discussed in point 4, classification of magnetic material. So I start with the first point, that is the force on a charged particle. So the force on a charged particle, force on a charged particle. Okay, so when we talk about the charged particles, so we denote a particle by a charge Q. This is a charge Q. Now this charge Q may be stationary or moving. So I can write this may be stationary or moving. So if we have a charge Q, what will be the force corresponding to this charge Q? Then the electrostatic force Fe, E for electrostatic force, will be QE. Both are the vector. F equals to QE. E is the electric field. E is your electric field. So the force corresponding to the charge Q is F equals to QE. Right. So this is responsible for a stationary charged particle. So this is applicable for stationary charged particles. Right? So this is applicable for the stationary charged particles. Now, what will be the force for the moving charge? If I say this charge Q is not a stationary, it's a moving. In this case, what may be the force formula? So I am writing here, for the moving charge, if charge is moving, we know that moving charge is associated with the magnetic field. For moving charge, a magnetic field, experience a force, and this force will be this one. F is equals to Q U cross B. This is for magnetic. So F magnetic is equals to Q U cross B. Now U is the velocity of this moving charged particle. So U is velocity of this moving charge. So this is the force formula corresponding to the moving charged particles. So what may be the generalized formula if we consider the stationary as well as the moving charge particle? So I can write a generalized form that total force F will be the Fe is corresponding to the electrostatic force, which is corresponding to the stationary charge particle, plus F magnetic.
So this is the total force.
So if I combine these two, 1 and 2, F will be Q E plus U cross B. This one. This is called the Lorentz force. This is known as the Lorentz force. Lorentz force. So the Lorentz force is the combination of the electrostatic force plus magnetic force. So this is the generalized force, the force on the charged particles. So particles may be moving or stationary. The generalized form will be given by this equation. Right. So this is the force. Next, magnetic dipole. Okay, so the question is, what is the magnetic dipole? Second is magnetic dipole. So I consider a bar magnet. So everyone is familiar with the bar magnets, right? So if I consider the bar magnets, so in a bar magnet we have the two pole. One is this one, let's I denote M1, and another is the M2. So this is the known as the two poles in this simple bar magnets. We can say it's a dipole. This is the dipole, magnetic dipoles. So I'm writing here a bar magnet or a small current carrying loop. Bar magnet or a small current loop is usually known as is a magnetic dipole. Right? So this two is usually known as the magnetic dipole. So if this is the magnetic dipole, then I can write the formula that the magnetic dipole moment is the product of current and area of the loop. This is important. The magnetic dipole moment is the product of the current and the area of this loop. So I can write T is equals to M cross B. The torque T is equals to M cross B. B is the magnetic field, M is the magnetic dipole. So the T will be M cross B. So let's we do a small exercise which is basically related with this current carrying loop, and our interest is to find out the magnetic dipole at a particular point P. So let's I draw a current carrying loop. Okay, so this is our current carrying loop, small loop, and current I is flow in this current carrying loop. So we denote a coordinates. This is X, this is Y, and this is Z. Let's the diameter of this loop is A. The diameter is the radius is A, the diameter is 2A, the radius is A, and we want to find out the magnetic field at a point P. Let this is the point P where we want to find out the magnetic field P. What will be the magnetic field B at this point P? So let's denote this coordinate system in a spherical coordinate system. So this is the R, this is the angle theta, and this is the last azimuthal angle phi, R theta phi. So I can say the point P will be denoted by R theta and phi. So this is the location of point P, and we want to find out the magnetic field B at this point P, right? So let's we want to determine the field at B. So what will be the vector potential? We already discussed about the vector potentials. So I start with the vector potentials. So I can write, therefore the magnetic vector potential, magnetic vector potential A is mu 0 I upon 4 pi di upon r. This is the vector potentials. A equals to mu 0 I upon 4 pi di upon r. R is this distance from 0 to point P. Right. Okay. So if we do the integrations, then the vector potentials will be mu 0 I pi a square upon 4 pi r square sin square theta a phi. This is the unit vector. I just saw these close integrations with these coordinates r theta and phi. So if I write the value of this current element di and do the integrations, then finally I will be converts my formula at a equals to mu 0 I pi a square sin square theta upon 4 pi r a square unit vector a phi. So this is the vector potentials, right? So if pi a square represent the cross sections area and I is the current, so initially I defined that current multiplied by the area is equals to the magnetic dipole. So I can write where magnetic dipole L is equals to I pi A square AZ. AZ, why AZ? Because it's along the Z direction. This cross section area is along the Z direction. The unit vector is perpendicular to this cross section area. So I pi A square. Right. So therefore I can write the magnetic flux density B will be mu 0. I just substitute this value M here, mu 0 M 4 pi R cube 2 cos theta AR plus sin theta A theta. These two are the unit vector AR and A theta. So this is the magnetic field of this magnetic field at point P due to this current carrying loop. So we say that B is directly proportional to this magnetic dipole M. So we derive the magnetic field in terms of a magnetic dipole. Next is magnetizations in a material. So basically magnetization in material. So basically magnetization is magnetic moment, dipole moment per unit volume is known as the magnetization. So I define the magnetization as the magnetization M, and the unit of this magnetization is ampere per meter. Is the magnetic dipole moment per unit volume. So this is the magnetic dipole moment per unit volume is our magnetization. The denominator of this unit ampere per meter. This is the unit of magnetization. So I consider the n number of atom. So if we have the n number of atom, if there are n number of atoms, in a given volume del V, our small volume is dV and the number of atoms are n in this volume, then magnetizations will be this one. M, remember this formula, M is equals to limit del V tends to 0. The meaning of this one, if we consider the small volume elements and the number of atoms in this small volume elements are n, then the magnetization M will be the summations K equals to 1 to n MK. This is the magnetic dipole corresponding to the different number of atoms. So this is the summation of all the magnetic dipole for n atoms divided by total volume dV. This is our magnetization for the n number of atoms or n number of particles. Right. So if we know the value of magnetization, what will be the current density? How we can write the current density in terms of the magnetization? So it's very simple. So I can write JB. B is the current density. JB is the current density. B is equals to del cross M, which is for the bound volume current density. Right. One more. This is the surface current density, which is represented by K, will be the same, will be the surface current density. So these two, del cross M. So current density J is equals to del cross M, same as the surface current density with the del cross M. Okay, so next is, what may be the relation between the magnetic field B and this magnetization? So I can write a formula which show the relation between the M and B. The relationship is very simple. B is equals to mu 0 H plus M. H plus M. So magnetization M, magnetic field is B. So we know if M is chi H, M equals to chi S. Basically chi is called the susceptibility. Chi is the susceptibility. So now I substitute the value M here, then the magnetic field B will be mu 0 1 plus chi H. I just substitute this value of M here. So if I substitute the value, my power will be H. So finally I have mu 0 1 plus chi H. Or I can write this is mu H, where mu is this part, mu 0 multiply 1 plus chi, so mu H. Or if I write B it equals to mu naught mu r H, mu naught is the permittivity of a free space, then and this is the permittivity of a material, then B equals to mu 0 mu r H. Therefore mu r it equals to 1 plus chi m or mu upon mu naught. This is one essence, but this is important. B is equal to mu 0 H plus M, which shows the relationship between the magnetization and the magnetic field. So now on the basis of this chi, I will be classifying the material into the different parts. Classification of materials. Okay, so next is the classification of magnetic materials. So we can classify the material into the two categories. One is called the non-magnetic and other is the magnetic material. And again we can classify the magnetic material into the three categories, which is called the diamagnetic, paramagnetic and the ferromagnetic, on the basis of the value of chi. So let's start with the classification of magnetic materials. So classify is basically classify by the magnetic susceptibility. Classify of magnetic material means classification on the basis of magnetic susceptibility. Magnetic susceptibility chi. Right. Magnetic susceptibility and one more parameter is permittivity. Permittivity. New one. So I start with the non-magnetic materials. So I am writing here non-magnetic materials. What may be the susceptibility of these non-magnetic materials? Non-magnetic. If chi m is 0 or mu r is equal to 1, this type of material is known as the non-magnetic materials. Examples: free space, air. These two are the examples of non-magnetic materials. The condition is that the magnetic susceptibility is 0. Next is the magnetic materials. Magnetic materials. And as I say, the magnetic materials is classified into the three categories, and these are the number one, diamagnetics. Number one is the diamagnetic material. Diamagnetic. So the property of the diamagnetic material is that if permittivity mu r is the less than 1, if permittivity mu r is the less than 1 and the susceptibility and chi m susceptibility is minus 1, this type of material is known as the diamagnetic material if the susceptibility is minus 1. So basically the meaning of this chi equals to minus 1 is we can understand with the simple example. Suppose electron is revolving around the nucleus. So revolving electrons have its own magnetic fields. If we have some external magnetic field, and if this internal and external magnetic field oppose each other, then I can say it's the diamagnetic property. In this case, chi will be minus 1. Second is paramagnetic material. Paramagnetic. If mu r is greater than 1, permeability is greater than 1, and susceptibility is plus 1, it's a positive. In diamagnetic, it's a negative, while in paramagnetic, it's a positive susceptibility. Then this type of material is known as the paramagnetic material. And the last is ferromagnetic if chi m is highly positive numbers, chi m is very greater than 1, then we can say it's a ferromagnetic material. So this type of material is known as the ferromagnetic materials. Right, so on the basis of the susceptibility, we classify the materials into these different categories. Next is ferronickel. So, Faraday's law basically found that whenever there is a charge in a magnetic flux linked with the circuit, and EMF is induced, resulting in a flow of a current in a circuit. So, I can say the electromotive force is will be equal to the change in the flux. That means if I write the EMF force EF, which will be equals to minus d phi upon dt, means change in the magnetic flux. So I am writing here the Faraday laws. So according to Faraday, a static magnetic field produce no current flow but a time varying time varying field produce and induce voltage which is called EMF, electromotive force. So the electromotive force will be for closed circuits. For a closed circuit, the electromotive force will be, I am writing here, induced EMF, electromotive force is VMF, VEMF minus N d psi upon dt, where N is the total number of turns and d psi upon dt represent the change in a magnetic flux, that means the change due to the time varying field, change in a magnetic flux. So this change in the magnetic flux produce electromotive force. Now the important is the minus sign. So basically this negative sign so that induced EMF act is in such a way that it opposes the flux produced in it. This is the important. The property of the minus sign is in such a way that it opposes the flux produced in it, which is called the Lenz law. This is known as the Lenz law. So now I apply this Faraday law for a closed circuit. So let's I draw a closed circuit, very simple closed circuit, which have a battery. So the corresponding force is EF, electric field is EF, and one more field is EE. And one resistance is connected here. Then total E electric field will be EF plus EE. This will be the EF plus EE, and this is EE is nothing but this electric field is change grade V, change in the potentials grade V. Right, so for this closed circuit, I can write the total flux EDL, LL for this complete cycle will be EF DL plus 0, which is N to P EF dot DL, or finally I can write electromotive force is minus N to P E DL. DL is this length, which is nothing but the simple IR, Ohm's law. E equals to IR. So by using this Faraday law, we can derive the electromotive force for this closed circuits. So today I discuss about the force on a charged particle, then the magnetic dipole, then magnetization in the materials, and on the basis of this magnetizations and the susceptibility, we characterize the magnetic material and the non-magnetic material, and again we characterize the magnetic material into the three different categories: diamagnetic, ferromagnetic and paramagnetic. And finally I discuss about the Faraday law, and we understand how we can find out the electromotive force by using this Faraday law. So here I stop it. Thank you.